I'd like to call to order the August 24th, 2023 meeting of the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission. This meeting is being streamed live and recorded as a public record. A recording of the meeting will be available at www.ncwildlife.org. As a courtesy to others, please check and turn off your cell phones during the meeting. And at this time, I'd like to recognize Commissioner Steve Windham for our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And at this time, I'd like to recognize Commissioner Jim Ruffin to return our invocation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to start with a quick reading inspired by Psalm 46:10 and then the invocation. Be still and know that I'm God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know. Be still. Be. Dear Lord, every day you provide us with many blessings and we are truly grateful. Every day that we are inspired by a majestic view. Every day we are in awe by your animals and nature. Every day that we experience the serenity of your shady woods, we become better. Our actions today provide experiences for others to make them better every day. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Commissioner Ruffin.
Very nice.
This time I'd recognize Margo Minkler to do a roll call of commissioners present. Margo.
Good morning. Going to do a roll call for commissioners present for our August 24th, 2023 meeting. Monty Crump.
Here.
Mark Craig.
Here.
David Hoyle.
Here.
John Coley.
Here.
Wes Seegers, Tommy Fumble,
here.
Tom Berry, Brad Stanback,
here.
Jim Ruffin,
here.
Ray Clifton,
here.
Kelly Davis,
here.
Steve Windham,
here.
Landon Zimmer,
here.
John Stone, Hayden Rogers, John Alexander, Tom Hayslip,
here.
J.C. Cole,
here.
Mike Alford,
here.
Mr. Chairman, you have a quorum.
Thank you, Margo. North Carolina General Statute 138A-15 mandates that the commission chair shall remind all commissioners of their duty to avoid conflicts of interest or appearances of conflicts under this chapter, and that the chair also inquires as to whether there are any known conflict of interest or appearance of conflict with respect to any matters coming before the commission at this time. It is the duty of each commissioner who is aware of such personal conflict of interest or of an appearance of a conflict to notify the chair of the same. And at this time, I will ask, are there any requests for refusals?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. In order to avoid a potential conflict, I would like to recuse myself from C5 in the Land Use Committee.
Okay, thank you. We will pull that out of and have separate votes on that at that time then to accommodate that recusal. Are there any more? Hearing none, the minutes of the July 13th minutes of the Wildlife Commission have been previously distributed to you in your agenda packet. Are there any additions or corrections or approvals noted at this time by any of the commissioners? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the July 13th meeting known as Exhibit A.
I move.
Second. Commissioner Ruffin, David Hall. All those in favor of approval, the minutes signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, minutes are approved. Now we'll move forward. And at this time, I recognize Jason Cottle to provide a financial status report on the Wildlife Resources Commission General Fund, Capital Improvement Fund, and Endowment Fund. Jason.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. We did our deep dive yesterday at the Finance Committee meeting into these figures, so today's presentation will be short and sweet. For fiscal 23, ending June 29, overall revenues in our general fund were $117,250,290.08. Overall expenditures, $117,237,311.20, leaving a fund balance as of June 29, $19,355,365.37. In our capital improvement fund for fiscal 23, we saw total revenues of $8,914,210.80 $287.04. Total expenditures in the same of $10,451,574.79 to leave us with a fund balance $1,744,548.06. Moving on to our endowment fund, again, as of June 2023, we saw a total fund balance of $165,430,756.91, represented by an asset allocation of approximately 76% equities, 20% bonds, and 4% short term. And, if there are no questions, then that concludes my presentation this morning.
Are there any questions or comments from any of the commissioners on the financial report? We went in detail yesterday at the Finance Committee. Hearing none, thank you, Jason. We'll move forward on the agenda, the committee reports. And at this time, I'd recognize David Hoyle, Vice Chair of the Rules Committee, for your report.
Thank you. The Rules Committee met yesterday to review the 24-25 annual cycle rule proposals and several other upcoming rule packages. First, the division chiefs presented inland fish, wildlife management, game lands, and law enforcement proposals. All proposals were approved to move forward to rulemaking, except for the wildlife management proposal to allow shed antlers to be sold, as the committee determined it was to be unnecessary. Next, proposed amendments to the public fishing and boating access area rules were discussed, which included creating motorized and non-motorized boating access areas and prohibiting concessions, food trucks at the boat access areas. Finally, the committee received details on the proposed commercial permanent rules relating to restricting and charging fees for unlicensed commercial activities and events on commission property. The committee agreed that staff should proceed with the physical impact evaluation and the rules should continue through the rulemaking process. We adjourn.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair. Are there any comments or questions from the Committee of Commissioners in reference to the Rules Committee report? Hearing none, we'll move forward at this time. I recognize Chairman J.C. Cole to provide Boating Safety Committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Boating Safety Committee met yesterday morning at 10:05. Began the meeting with Betsy Haywood presenting no wait zone rules for notice of text in Brunswick County, Forsyth, Rockingham, and Stokes County, Caldwell County, and the town of Rodas. Next, Major Mark Dutton gave the committee a very informative presentation on the law enforcement division's boating safety update. Our law enforcement staff have been hard at work on multiple campaigns to ensure folks are participating responsibly on the waters. While we are seeking some improvements, we still have had 12 fatal boating incidents this year, but only four of those incidents reported the use of a personal flotation device. There being no additional business, the committee adjourned at 10:42. That'll be our report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Are there any comments or questions for the Boating Safety Committee report? Hearing none, at this time I recognize Chairwoman Kelly Davis, the Habitat Non-Game Endangered Species Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Habitat Non-Game and Endangered Species Committee met on August 23rd, 2023 at 10:42 a.m. The committee received two very informative presentations, beginning with Michael Fisk's presentation on the restoration efforts for priority aquatic species in the Tar and Neuse River basins, focusing on the Tar River spiny mussel, yellow lance, and Carolina mad tom. Michael highlighted the conservation actions to date and identified the importance of future reintroductions and the Safe Harbor Agreement to reach conservation goals for these species. John Carpenter and Scott Anderson provided an update on the first 3 years of the North Carolina Bird Atlas, a five-year project. As of this month, more than 2.4 million bird observations have been recorded by more than 2,000 volunteer atlasers who have spent almost 120,000 hours birding throughout North Carolina. Bird Atlas data will help inform management, monitoring, and research needs for species of greatest conservation needs, such as loggerhead shrike. Extensive outreach efforts by the NCBA team have built a community of volunteers enjoying outdoor activities, learning about North Carolina's birds, and contributing valuable data to the commission. Rachel Hoke provided a brief update on the implementation of WRC's programmatic Safe Harbor and candidate conservation agreements. The committee approved the staff recommendation to include an additional area in the Swannanoa River Basin or the spot fin chub reintroduction proposal so the commission can enroll an interested landowner into the safe harbor agreement. Shannon Deaton reviewed the votes received for the Thomas L. Quay Wildlife Diversity Award from the July committee meeting. On behalf of the committee, I would like to make a motion to award David H. Allen the Thomas L. Quay Wildlife Diversity Award for 2023.
You have a motion from the committee chair. Is there a second?
Second.
A motion and a second. Commissioner Vonville.
Discussion?
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you. That concludes my report. Thank you.
Any further comments, questions from the commissioners? Reference to Habitat Non-Game Endangered Species Committee report. Here none, we'll move forward to Land Acquisitions and Property Committee report. Brad Stanback, Vice Chair.
Land Acquisition and Property Committee met on August 23rd. Committee reviewed and endorsed three phase one land acquisition proposals, as well as eight phase two land acquisition proposals. Total, the committee reviewed 11 land acquisition projects, total of 2,322 acres. Acquisitions range from game land additions, establishment of new game land in Alexander, Wilkes, Iredell counties, and property in Gaston County for new land and water access depot. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Brad. Are there any questions, comment on our report? We'll move forward to the Finance Committee report. Chairman Landon Zimmer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Finance Audit and Compliance Committee met yesterday at August 23rd, 2023. First, in the finance portion, Amna Cameron from the North Carolina Department of Transportation provided a presentation demonstrating flat revenue projections of gas tax disbursements to NCWRC over the next several years. The presentation displayed a plateau in gas tax revenue, but a decline in a previous forecast where growth was projected. CFO Jason Cottle then presented a year-over-year comparison of revenues and expenditures in both the general fund and capital projects fund, offering explanation for any variances in excess of $1 million. On to the internal audit portion, Auditor Chase presented a wrap-up summary of the Bank of America Works project. This project increased efficiency and improved internal controls in the purchasing card system. Then the results of the staff fiscal year 2024 risk assessment were also presented. The committee supported including constituent accessibility to license and vessel services by wildlife service agents in the new Go Outdoors NC system to the list of risks to be considered. These risks will be incorporated into the fiscal year 2024 audit plan. Jason Cottle also presented an overview of the endowment fund balance and current asset allocation was presented, and a recommendation was made to the board to set target allocations for various funds. The committee agreed to set a minimum of 80% for the equity index fund, a minimum of 5% for the short-term interest fund with a maximum of 20%, and with bond index fund holdings to be phased out over time. Therefore, I'd like to make the motion on behalf of the Finance Committee to move that the Commission set a target investment strategy for the Wildlife Endowment Fund to reach and maintain a minimum of 80% in the equity index fund, a minimum of 5% in the short-term interest fund, and to reduce the bond index fund to 0% over time.
You have a motion from Chair of Finance. We got a second from Commissioner Stanback, Vice Chair of Finance. Are there any further discussions on the motion, comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, and that concludes my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I will now give a report on Committee of the Whole. Committee of the Whole met yesterday afternoon. Prior to beginning, we welcomed a very special visitor, Senator Mary Wills Bodie. Senator Bodie spoke briefly about her background as an enthusiast and participant in various outdoor activities and of passing along those traditions to her nieces and nephews. She also recognized the important role of the Commission's conservation mission. We then moved into rulemaking with Melva Bonner, presenting proposed changes to various administrative rules in Columbus County game lands for potential adoption and permanent rules for hunter education course rules for notice of text. Fairley Mayhem and Jamie Hall then showed us three of 12 new humorous videos that will be released to encourage people to be bear wise and not have negative interactions with black bears. I discussed new committee assignments and the importance of committee's work to our success in the formation of the new ad hoc committee to review and assess Wildlife Commission agency supplemental funding model. The committee charged is to examine and bring back recommendations on potential changes to fees for non-traditional users of all of our infrastructure. Lastly, Christian Waters provided a valuable update on the upcoming flounder season, the differences between our rules and those of the MFC, and the fact that our rules pertaining to hook and line apply in joint waters as well as in inland waters. That concludes my report. Are there any questions or comments reference to that? Hearing none, we will move forward. And this time I will call on Shannon Deaton to recognize her to introduce speakers for this commission meeting, agency spotlight, Green Growth Toolbox, working with communities for conservation.
Good morning. I'm happy to introduce Brooke Massa, who is with the Habitat Conservation Division. She's a land conservation biologist, and she has been with us for nearly 12 years and is stationed in the Sykes Depot. While her responsibilities include working with regional conservation partners and helping conduct site assessments for some of our land acquisitions, today I'm happy to say that she's here to share with you some of her work on the Green Growth Toolbox. Some of you may have heard of that, but today you will hear about how this tool fosters discussions for conservation planning while informing local ordinances and their development with local governments. I'm going to hand it over to Brooke now.
Okay, thanks, Shannon. Good morning. Thank you for giving us this time to talk to you about, this sounds kind of strange to me. Does that sound okay to you?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to talk to you about the Green Growth Toolbox program. I am happy to be co-presenting today with my colleague, Jake Petrosky, who's a practice leader in planning at Seward Consultant. They do long-range planning with communities. And we may have the planning director from Chatham County coming as well. His name is Jason Sullivan. He may have some issues coming in from Pittsburgh, it seems. So we'll see if he shows up. So what is the Green Growth Toolbox? It's a non-regulatory technical assistance program that is targeted towards local government planning. It's to help support local government planning and integrating information on wildlife habitat and natural resources conservation information into their land use and transportation planning. It's led by the Habitat Conservation Division, as Shannon mentioned. And the purpose of this program is to address the habitat loss and fragmentation that is being caused by the rapid pace of development in North Carolina. So as you all know, North Carolina is one of the fastest growing states in the country. And as so, the loss and fragmentation of habitat is one of the leading threats to wildlife populations in our state. Excuse me. So this Wildlife Resources Commission began thinking about working with land use planners back in 2005 when they started an urban wildlife program. And in that position, there was a biologist who identified that there was a need to start to train land use planners on how to gather and interpret conservation data, that is data on like the locations of important natural areas and species that occur in their jurisdictions, and bring that data into land use planning. And how could planners do that? And she identified that need and decided at the same time that she was doing a master's at NC State and she would make that her master's thesis. So she developed this pilot Green Growth Toolbox program, which at that point was a draft guidance document to share with land use planners. And then she did a draft workshop basically with Chatham County planning staff. So Chatham County, including Jason Sullivan, who hopefully will show up today, was the first pilot community to work with the Green Growth Toolbox back in 2007. And from that, the commission decided that they wanted to initiate a more formalized program, and they polished up the materials and developed the Green Growth Toolbox program in 2009. And in 2010, we received funding to start permanently staffing that program. And since around 2009, we've had Casey Cook, who was recently moved into wildlife management as the coastal waterbird biologist, has been working on the Green Growth Toolbox, and myself being hired in 2012. She and I have been working alongside one another to bring this work to communities ever since. So what is in the Green Growth Toolbox? Well, the Green Growth Toolbox is a set of tools or a set of resources that is tailored towards land use planners. But we hope that the tools are accessible to anybody who's interested in this topic, whether it be you'll be a resident of a particular community or a natural resource professional that wants to speak on some issues going on in your own community. So what it is a handbook that's tailored to land use planners. It deals with a variety of planning topics that land use planners deal with on a day-to-day basis. It provides accurate and up-to-date conservation data that is available statewide, and that is GIS data that shows planners where their important natural areas and wildlife habitats and wildlife species occur within their jurisdictions. We have a website where we gather all those materials together and make it easy to access for planners, hopefully. We provide training workshops and presentations. So we tailor these to the needs of the community. So sometimes we do a whole day long workshop where we get 50 planners from an area together to do green growth, to learn about green growth. Or we do lunch and learns with consulting firms. We give short presentations to elected officials or planning boards or other types of community advisory boards. And during COVID, we were able to shift and start doing some webinars. So we did have a webinar series out when we were doing everything remote. One of the other important tools in the toolbox is technical assistance. So biologists will work with the community to review ordinances or review land use plans or comprehensive plans and provide non-regulatory recommendations in those planning documents and then how to enhance conservation outcomes through that process. Lastly, we have a small pot of funding called Partners for Green Growth that provides cost share assistance communities that are interested in doing conservation planning but may not have the capacity to do that on staff. And so they need a little extra money to get them started. So I do want to make mention that the Green Growth Toolbox was developed in partnership with many, many partners. And the tools that you just saw were developed in partnership with these partners that are on this slide, including state and federal agencies, nonprofit conservation organizations like the Nature Conservancy and land trusts, as well as regional councils of government and conservation partnerships that exist on a regional scale. But the most important partner that we work with is not on this slide, and that would be the local governments that actually implement the Green Growth Toolbox. They bring it to their communities, and that's where the rubber hits the road. And so those local governments are not on the slide, unfortunately, but they are our biggest partner in this effort. So with our partners, what we've been able to accomplish over about the past 14 years is to train staff from over 100 local and regional government agencies or organizations through workshops and webinars. We've informed the development of over 75 land use plans, ordinances, and development designs. And we funded 16 conservation planning projects through the Partners for Green Growth. I just lost my train of thought. So with all this, I want to So what I was going to say is I would love to speak to you in detail about some of these deliverables that we've been able to accomplish over time, but I'd rather yield my time to some of my colleagues I've had the pleasure to work with over the past 10 years, one being Jake Potoski, again, the planning practice leader at a Stewart consulting firm, which does long range planning with communities. He's brought the Green Growth Toolbox to communities across the state. And also if Jason Sullivan comes again, he is in charge of the planning department in Chatham County, which I think Chatham County is the leading local government in terms of doing conservation based land use planning. They're doing innovative projects. They've gotten Partners for Green Growth projects, Partners for Green Growth funding to support innovative conservation projects. So I hope that he can come and share his perspective too, but if not, I'm very happy to hand it over here to Jake and let you learn from what he's been doing. Thanks, Jake.
Thanks, Brooke. Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Jake Petrosky with Stewart. Just to give you a kind of a snapshot, we do plans for local governments, counties, and towns all across the state. So each dot is kind of one of the plans we've worked on, ordinances. So just to give you a sense, and you know, this is kind of our reach and folks that we touch, and green growth principles really apply across North Carolina. What we're seeing is no secret. You know, North Carolina has grown by 2.5 million people in the last 20 years. That equates to about 1 million new homes. So North Carolina is in demand from the mountains to the coast, and that's not really changing. More is coming. How we accommodate that growth is really important, and how we plan our cities and design our neighborhoods and where we incur growth will have significant impact on the natural resources in the state. One of the stats in the Green Growth Toolbox is that on average 67,000 acres of forests and fields are developed each year. Where that occurs is really important to the biodiversity of North Carolina long term. The benefits of the Green Growth Toolbox is it's a playbook on how to balance conservation with accommodation of well-designed development. It's a process, and it has resources for the objective identification and evaluation and triage of natural resources to really inform how cities and counties grow over the next coming years. It provides concrete and actionable recommendations on how to improve land use and development practices, and it provides a scientific basis for recommendations that can really lead to much broader support for shared goals in terms of incorporating green space and doing conservation at a local level. I'm going to just touch on a couple different projects that I've had the pleasure of working on across the state. In the Charlotte area, the Harrisburg Area Land Use Plan and other work in Cabarrus County has been really really good at advancing ideas in the Green Growth Toolbox and encouraging more sensitive development patterns. This plan in particular identified the Reedy Creek Basin as being a really important area for biodiversity. There's four natural heritage natural areas, and it's really in the crosshairs of growth. So what the idea here was to encourage a development pattern that utilized conservation subdivisions and incentives to encourage more open space and new development, with the idea being that public funds and land trusts cannot preserve all the unique natural resources in this area. So if the policies are followed in this plan, we could actually preserve 4,000 acres of land, the most important land, in open space long term. And that could not be done with public funds or land trust funds. So that's the importance of this on a local level. Pittsburgh is another example. We work with Brooke to identify priority habitats and wildlife and species of conservation need in the area, and then identify a natural resources conservation overlay to really target the preservation of some of the most important areas. A lot of this is about education too, education of elected and appointed boards and also citizens on what unique resources are in their backyard. This can really lead to increased support for preservation. And looking at alternative development concepts, looking at conventional by right zoning versus alternatives that can incentivize protection of open space, going from 10 or 12% open space to 40% open space can have really significant impacts on species at a local level. E.O. Wilson in his Half Earth book and his studies, he found that an increase of open space or natural area of 10% can lead to a doubling of species presence. So this can happen on a local level, and it really comes down to ordinances and incentives and development patterns. Another interesting thing on the Pittsburgh Land Use Plan, we did a story map where you can actually go and look at different natural resources, look at the different species that are present in different habitats in the Pittsburgh area. So it provides that kind of educational opportunity as well. Up in the mountains, the story is similar. The reasons for change are different, but we have urban expansion and suburban expansion, second home development competing with sensitive natural resources, apple orchards and agricultural interests as well. So using green growth principles, looking at how to encourage sensitive development design in some of these areas was a real key kind of emphasis area in that plan. So the future work, really looking at kind of what's next, is there's a lot of need here. Development patterns and the design of those developments are a key determinant of species and habitat conservation success or failure, water quality and quality of life in North Carolina over the next 25 years. State law requires municipal and county planning if you have zoning. So this is a good vehicle to influence change. And it's an opportunity for education and to shape the future of the built environment and natural environment in North Carolina. And I think there's a lot of good things to come related to using green growth principles and on the ground. I can talk a little bit about Chatham County.
Yeah,
sure. Yeah. So I helped Jason in Chatham County with the comprehensive plan, which was one of the first things that kind of incorporated some of these principles. You know, that well, they provided input on the Green Growth Handbook before it came out. And then they were a Partners for Green Growth grant recipient that informed Plan Chatham, which was the comprehensive plan. And it had overarching policies and recommendations for conservation in the county in order to target county efforts and nonprofit efforts and also development design. But it also had what was the Big Woods Conservation Design Guide, which was really looking at a designated natural heritage natural area that was largely intact for a number of reasons, interestingly, in kind of Northeast Chatham, despite a lot of growth pressure in that area. And it really looked at that natural area, and we had a workshop where landowners and conservation folks and biologists came together and planners and talked about the issues and how to balance everything that was going on and you know, preserve the natural resources that are unique to the area, but also accommodate some growth and preserve property rights too, because that's a really big a big need when we're talking about this. And what came out of it was specific recommendations for the area around the Big Woods Natural Heritage Natural Area to encourage kind of a development pattern that tried to balance these things. Some of the recommendations in that plan actually led to some data being available on the GIS conservation viewer at the county level. So that is used by citizens and developers and planners during development review process, and how to identify, okay, we're requiring open space in this area. Where should that priority open space be? Because there's a lot of difference between what you preserve, right? It can have a lot of benefit or very little benefit. And then some of those ideas are making their way into the Unified Development Ordinance, which is basically their zoning ordinance that are the specific standards for, you know, how to design new development in different zoning districts and how to, you know, protect open space and priority open space and that sort of thing. So that's underway right now. So and they're also doing some metrics and tracking on the implementation plan. So they have a history of this. They've been doing this for a number of years in terms of you know, preserving open space. And one of the things is, well, how are we doing related to these big picture conservation goals? So this next project is really looking at metrics and tracking, well, how much open space have we preserved via public efforts and nonprofit efforts, but then also through private development. And, you know, eventually the goal is to start connecting these pieces of open space. So you have these wildlife corridors and even some areas that are restored in some cases where you have agricultural land and then you're encouraging or putting, you know, new development there. There actually can be restoration of riparian areas and other areas that have been degraded over time. So ideally they want to look and see how they're doing overall with all these kind of policies and standards put in place. So it's really exciting.
Hi, Jason, you can come on up. This is Jason Sullivan, the planning director of Chatham County. I know it's probably a long drive for you. I appreciate
And trying to get a fleet vehicle from Chatham County is a challenge. Well, good morning. Sorry for my tardiness this morning.
You know, Jake kind of covered some of
okay.
this.
Oh, great. Wait. Okay. Well, I won't belabor anything. I just want to extend my appreciation to the Wildlife Resources Commission and your staff for all the efforts that you do working with local governments. Some of what you see on the screen are activities that Wildlife Resources Commission staff have been involved with every step of the way in helping Chatham County with our conservation efforts. So either the Green Growth Handbook, the Partners for Green Growth grants, as well as all the efforts that they help us with in the county have been greatly appreciated.
Thank you, Jason.
Sure.
Well, I'm glad you were able to they're from both Jason and Jake, and I want to thank you both for making it here today. I think you coming up, showing up, it helps demonstrate the value of partnerships with this program, because we cannot do this without partners. So thank you, and thank you to all for your attention and the opportunity to come speak with you today. And I think if you have questions, we have some time to answer questions. So.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, no, very nice. What have you seen from, like, and are there any silver bullets or anything? I mean, I would think, I mean, what I'm talking about is like maybe green roof or something where the open space is not purely at the expense of development, or, you know, where it's not a zero sum game, where you can see some kind of marrying of both progress or development in addition to kind of open space, like a pond thing, like pollinator garden or something. Have you seen, what examples have you seen that kind of have both in there instead of one at the expense of the other? Or is that not the case?
Yeah, well, the conservation designs that we promote are incentive-based, so that if a developer is to set aside part of that tract in open space, they would get a bonus, usually like a density bonus or some other types of incentives.
You know,
like
vertical density bonus? Or
it could be vertical. It could be, you know, just a number of units. Or it could be, you know, reduced lot size, which can really, you know, make it more advantageous for developers to you know, save money on projects too. That's another thing that's really interesting with these conservation designs is, on average, you know, there's a 30% cost savings on length of roadways and the amount of stormwater infrastructure that's needed and stuff like that. So it really can be, you know, a win-win for the property owner and developer, but then also for, you know, kind of conservation interests and that sort of thing. Green roofs are good too for a more urban context. I mean, that's, you know, there's a lot of kind of more urban things too. We focus a lot on the suburban situation, but there's also the suburban ideas.
And following up on what Jake was saying from Chatham County's experience, we have a conservation subdivision option, and Wildlife Resources Commission staff have helped us with that. It's incentive based. So what we do in Chatham County is we encourage developers to choose that option. They don't have to, but in for the additional set aside, if they set aside 40% of the property, they get a 10% density bonus, reduced lot sizes. They have greater flexibility with the layout design. And we also were able to partner with the North Carolina Natural Heritage Program to identify those high quality environmental areas on the site. And we've seen great success with that program.
Thank you.
Just a quick, like, percentage, how many opt in, how many developers opt in to the...
Since 2008, when we first implemented the conservation subdivision option, I'd say offhand, gosh, probably around 30%.
Yeah.
And it's dependent on the availability of water, sewer. But we've seen actually subdivisions with well and septic for the first time that are choosing that option, which we didn't really think was a possibility. But we actually have two that are actually under construction right now that chose that option. And it's that flexibility with the layout and the design that really prompted that developer to choose that option versus the conventional subdivision layout.
And it's not appropriate everywhere. In some cases, you want more of a traditional, you know, extension of the street grid and extension of, you know, kind of traditional development pattern of like a city or town, right? So that's why, you know, the planning process and these town plans, comprehensive plans are a really important part of this, is to really triage areas where this type of development is most appropriate and most advantageous.
What other counties around Wake County other than Chatham have y'all worked with?
I've probably trained most of the counties around this area.
Lee County.
Lee? Actually, no, I don't think we've made that much. We have spoken with some of the, I would say this is now over maybe almost 10 years ago when I last spoke to a city or a county commissioner in Lee County who was interested in the Green Growth Toolbox, but it's not part of my work region. So I'm not sure. I don't believe that we've done a lot in Lee County. Yeah.
Any further questions? Hearing none, thank you for the presentation. It's very enlightening.
Thank you.
Very promising. Get to catch the lights for us there, Mallory. This time we'll move forward with, and I'll call on and recognize Ben Solomon to present Land and Water Access Division reports. When he gets through, we'll go through the motions like I do, what we need, because we're going to have to pull one out to meet the refusal that we got on the table. And then when you get through, we'll move forward.
Do you want the marks?
No, I can just go through.
With the proper motion.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Land acquisition and property matters for today will include eight phase two land acquisitions. Starting with exhibit C1, which is our Reuben tract, and excuse my clicking, we'll have to go through these pretty quick. But the Reuben tract is 36 acres. It's in Ashe County. We'll be purchasing this for $162,300. Exhibit C2 is the Brushy Mountains donation from Blue Ridge Conservancy, as well as Foothills Conservancy. This is 1,125 acres in Alexander, Iredell, and Wilkes counties. Exhibit C3 is the Peterson tract, which is a 96-acre tract in Ashe County. This is a donation from the Nature Conservancy as well. Exhibit C4 is the Pine Mountain tract. The Pine Mountain tract is an addition to Thurman Chatham game land. It's 740 acres in Wilkes County. Exhibit C5 is the Surratt Road DOT transfer. This is a reallocation from NCDOT. It's a 156-acre tract in Davidson County, which will be an addition to Yakin River game land. Exhibit C6 is the Mount Holly Depot site. This is an acquisition using agency funds in the amount of $115,000. The tract is in Gaston County and will provide a new construction site for our new Mount Holly Depot. Exhibit C7 is the Simlin tract. The Simlin tract is an addition to Butner Falls game land in Durham County. It is a 5.69 acre donation from Ellerby Creek Watershed Association. And our final phase two exhibit is exhibit C8, which is the Rash Ayres donation. This is a donation from Blue Ridge Conservancy. This is located in Ashe County at our Three Top Mountain game land and is very, not quite adjacent, but very near to the TNC Peterson track donation. Mr. Chairman, this concludes all of our land and property matters from yesterday.
Okay, and this time I'll entertain a motion and a second for approval or adoption of C1, C2, C3, C4, C6, C7, and C8.
I move.
A motion from Commissioner Stanback. I have a second from Mike Alford. He got his up first. So.
Thank you.
Are there any further comments or questions on the motion to approve these phase two acquisitions as presented? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion passes. And at this time, to accommodate the recusal that we have, I'll ask for a motion and a second for approval of Exhibit C5. Mr. Stanback and Commissioner Kelly.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any further questions or comment on approval of Exhibit C5? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Approved. Motion passes, and we'll move forward at this time. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, thank you.
This time I recognize Melva Bonner for permanent rulemaking adoption. We'll take these motions separately. So after her presentation, we'll move forward with consideration of those two rulemaking adoption recommendations. Melva.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, everyone. The first rulemaking item on the agenda today is for the permanent readoption of various subchapter 10A rules, exhibits D1 and D2, which includes 10A0401, form and contents of petition, 10A0402, action on petition, 10A1101, waiver, 10A1201, emergency powers. The proposed amendments to these rules are determined to be necessary with substantive public interest and are required to be readopted as part of the periodic review. For 10A0401, 10A0402, 10A 1201, the proposed rule language has been updated and modified to conform with the current requirements. 10A1101 is proposed for a repeal. The movement of captive service is no longer under the jurisdiction of the commission. The second rulemaking item on the agenda today is for the permanent adoption of 10D0220, Columbus County Gameland in Columbus County, Exhibits E1 and E2. The executive director received a petition for rulemaking on February 14, 2023. The petitioner requested a rule amendment to prohibit hunting deer with the use of dogs in a Wananish tract of Columbus County Gameland, south of Highway NC-214. At the July 13, 2023 commission business meeting, the commission voted to initiate rulemaking proceedings. At this time, staff recommends the permanent adoption of the various subchapter 10A rules, and staff does not recommend the permanent adoption of 10D0220 Columbus County Gameland in Columbus County, as presented in at the yesterday's committee of the whole.
Thank you, Melva. And at this time, I'll entertain, and does anybody have any questions? Hearing none, at this time, I entertain a motion for the approval adoption of Exhibit D2, the first permanent rulemaking adoption on the various 10A rules.
So moved.
Got a motion from
second.
Second from Mr. Windham. Are there any questions or comment or further debate? Hearing none, all those in favor of adoption of Exhibit D2, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. This time I'll entertain a motion related to permanent rulemaking adoption in D.022 Columbus County Gamelands, which is known as Exhibit E.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to not adopt.
There a second?
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Got that, Margo? Are there any further comments or debate, questions? Hear none. All those in favor of the motion to not approve Exhibit E2, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carries. Thank you, Melva.
Okay. The third and final rulemaking item on the agenda today is for the notice of rules in the 10K0100 Hunter Education Course section, Exhibits F1 and F2, which includes 10K0101 Course Requirements, 10K0102 Issuance of Certificate of Competency, 10K0103 Instructor Certification. The proposed amendments to these rules were determined to be necessary with substantive public interest and are required to be readopted as part of the periodic review. For 10K0101, 10K0102, and 10K0103, the proposed rule language has been updated to clarify and to align with the North Carolina General Statutes and the rule and the current formatting requirements. 10K0102, the proposed amendment also clarifies the Hunter Education courses completed in other states or provinces are recognized if the course meets or exceeds the International Hunter Education Association standards. For 10K0103, the proposed amendment also removes the allowance of the abbreviated Hunter Education course for teachers and individuals certified as instructors in other states. The amendment also includes an increase for the Hunter Education instructor's passing score from 75% to 80%. At this time, staff recommends approval to notice the permanent readoption of the 10K0100 Hunter Education course rules, to open a 60-day public comment period, and to hold one public hearing as presented at yesterday's Committee of the Whole.
Any questions? Hear none, I'll ask for a motion to entertain a motion and a second for approval of Exhibits F1 and F2 as presented.
Move.
A motion, Commissioner Ruffin. Have a second.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Craig. Any further comments, questions, debate? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. They're adopted as presented. This time we'll move forward. Thank you, Melvin, very much. And at this time we'll move forward and I'll recognize Betsy Haywood. And here again, we'll take all these together as one, Betsy.
Yes, sir. Thank you. This morning we have for your consideration three proposed amendments to water safety rules as discussed in yesterday's boating safety committee meeting, and one proposed notice of text for a new rule and adoption of one fiscal note review for the town of Rodehiss. Discussed yesterday, we had three amendments. The first is 15A NCAC 10F.0305 Brunswick County for a no wake zone in a portion of Lockwood Folly River at Ruark's Landing subdivision. And you may find the rule text in Exhibit G. Next, 15A NCAC 10F.0316 for Scythe, Rockingham, and Stokes County, a no wake zone in Rockingham County on Belews Lake at Carolina Marina. Rule text found in Exhibit H. 15A NCAC 10F.0338 Caldwell County for a no wake zone within 50 yards of the marina facilities at Castle Bridge Marina on Lake Rodehiss in Granite Falls, and incorporate descriptions of four boating access areas on Lake Rodehiss and Lake Hickory in Caldwell County. Text in Exhibit I. Then a request to publish notice of text in the North Carolina Register with open comment period and a public hearing for a new rule, 15A NCAC 10F.0380, the town of Rodehiss, for a no wake zone on Lake Hickory shore to shore from a point 165 yards east of State Route 1611 Bridge westward to the Rodehiss Dam. Rule text in Exhibit J1. Finally, staff also requests commission adoption of the fiscal note for rulemaking expenses that will be incurred by the town of Rodehiss for this rule, Exhibit J2.
Thank you, Betsy. Are there any questions or comments from the commissioners in reference any of Betsy's presentation on the water safety rules? Notice of text. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second on Exhibits G, H, I, J1, and J2. Windham and Hull. Any further comments or questions, debate? Hearing none, all those in favor of adoption is presented. Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
Motion carries. They're adopted.
Thank you.
The only comments I have today are we hopefully are moving very closely to having a groundbreaking at Samarkand. We had a couple issues with getting power to the facilities. I think those are in motion to be resolved. So as soon as we get that underway and construction underway, we'll set up a groundbreaking and a visit for the commissioners. Some of you have been there, some of you haven't. And so we'll go down and look at the facility after the construction starts and look at and have a visit for the entire facility and see what's there. I think you'll find it very informative. So we'll be getting that information out pretty quickly, and I'm pretty confident we'll be doing it before the October meeting. We'll be getting that information out as soon as we can. I have no further comments. Are there any other comments from any of the commissioners? Will I call on executive director? Anything else? If not, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And like always, don't take it lightly. I'd like to thank everybody on the board and the new committee assignments. Staff is really excited, and thank you for stepping up to the new committee assignments and also with new committees. I also want to thank the staff as usual, but looking around the room today, we've got several volunteers that have been assisting. I was very fortunate to get into a conversation with Mr. Richardson there from Wake County Wildlife Club. I got to talk to him this morning, and his long-term volunteering with the Wildlife Commission and Hunter Ed and involvement in youth engagement with Hunter Safety 30 plus years. Thank you for volunteering with that, and I enjoyed our conversation. Also, I see our other partners around the room with cities and with other NGOs. So thank each one of y'all for being here today and your engagement in conservation in North Carolina. Lastly, I wanted to, as we have noted, we've been really excited about our Go Outdoors platform. And as many parts of the state transition from boating to dove season and into the woods for deer season, I want to thank everybody that's been engaged in that. And I want to reassure our constituents, our license holders, and our agents that we are fully committed. We understand is we are selling license, and we're excited about our new platform. It always comes with some challenges, and we are constantly working through those challenges. But thank each and every one of our folks across the state for their involvement and patience, and also appreciation that we've heard from them with our new platform of Go Outdoors. So, Mr. Chairman, that concludes my comments.
No business to be conducted. Meeting adjourned.